Now, what in the world is a libertarian doing recognizing and remembering Bob Kaufman? I have to say that I never really approached Bob. He approached me, especially in the last several years. He would call me up saying, we have to talk. There's a lot of things that we need to talk about. And we did talk about things. We share the understanding that the war on drugs is a disgrace, that is really hurting people. We share the notion that the never-ending wars, Iraq, Afghanistan, whatever they are a disgrace. They're criminal acts, really. Like I said, he's the one who approached me. And we shared an avocation, actually. He always ran for office. I always run for office. You never know whether you're going to get in or not. You do it with the intent of getting in. But in the meantime, you know you got to make a point. We both understood that even though there are a few decent people in government, by and large, they're a bunch of thieves. And I always heard about Bob being very contentious, et cetera, even getting thrown out of meetings and stuff. But in none of my dealings with Bob, I ever experienced any of that. None of it. And he knew that I disagreed. See, we agreed in the problems. We disagreed in the solutions. That really was the difference. That was the divide. And when I got the message that this event was going on, I said, I've got to go. Because at the end of the day, we're all human beings. We cannot live at war. We have to use persuasion, intelligence, caring, and I really don't care if somebody's a communist or not. Just don't force me to be one. I won't force you to be a libertarian. You know, and that is really what it's supposed to be. So, not only am I a libertarian, but I'm a believer as well. I'm not an atheist or an agnostic or anything like that. And I feel blessed that Bob wanted to talk to me and that I knew Bob. God bless Bob Kaufman.
Was that I saw a kindred spirit in him in the way he went about his politics. First of all, passion. Second of all, he wasn't afraid to be angry. And I think, especially in the left, you know, we've gone through this period in the last 50, 60 years in the left where people always talking about, oh, you've got to come off reasonable, you got to come off calm, pedagogic. Well, you know, there are some things that deserve justifiable anger and rage. Especially in these days. I mean, Lorenzo talked about the war, these wars as an example. I think rage is a justifiable, kind of response to that. And that's why I really...
Maybe we're killing a dog, but killing people is okay.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I fell in love with Bob. I only got to, you know, really have discussions with him 5 or 6 times. We always got along great, even though politically we were probably at odds more than not in a lot of things, but just that he had a way of conveying the passion. I mean, I remember one time he was up on stage with Kevin and several of the other Senate candidates in 2006, and I just remember point after point after point that Bob would drive home, and it just was making these Democrats squirm, because it was, you know, Bob was there showing to everybody these were phonies, basically, you know. And, you know, so anyway, that's why I fell in love with him. I think he's sorely missed. I mean, I remember the night we found out about the stabbing, when was that, in 2006, I believe it was, 2005. I mean, you know, for a person that I knew a very short time and had only had discussions with such a short, it really shocked me, hit me, because I really valued that passion in Bob. So, you know, to those of you who push pedagogy and be calm and all that, you know, there's a time and a place for that. There's a time for every season, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, also, I urge you to leave a little bit open for the people with that kind of passion that Bob put forward. I think we really need more of that in this time.
But you could almost say that he forgave the person who hurt him so badly, in the sense that he was saying, if this person had been able to get drugs legally, you know, he might not have been driven to such a desperate act. And I think that's quite, I mean, talk about being true to your principles and your beliefs. You know, Bob did not believe in the so-called war on drugs, and he was, you know, and even when someone attacked him with a knife, and I think he's dead now because of
tire arm.
Anyway, I think he's dead now because of the residual effects of that attack. You know, that it really, his health went downhill from that. But still, he made the connection. You know, I don't have anything personal against this guy. If he'd been able to get his drugs legally, he might never have done this to me. You know, I'd be believing, I guess, that he didn't really have anything personally against Bob. Just he was just trying to get some money because he was, you know, a slave to his habit. But anyway, so I really wanted to bring that out. And also, I think that another surprising thing about Bob was that he had a talent for making money in an entrepreneurial sense. And I'm probably, because of his convictions, he didn't develop that to the max. He probably could have been a rich man.
And those of you who said that Bob was not contentious at meetings, maybe we weren't all at the same meetings. But nevertheless, I probably disagree with Bob on many aspects of Marxism. At the same time, I have a deep and abiding respect for Marx because he was a warrior. I guess it's something, the dialectics of things. I learned a lot from Bob because I had to have answers in responding to him because I respected his beliefs. So therefore, I had to do some research or homework or whatever, and so Bob made me made me learn how to disagree. The big thing that Bob helped me to do was to learn how to deal with a contentious person in a large meeting. How do you do that? How do you do that? You have respect for this person. You know this person is a wonderful, hard worker. Once we agree on a perspective, these were usually coalitions, and Bob wanted to, you know, a lot of times to be a coalition based on Bob's perspectives. But I learned how to help to do that, not as an individual, but when other persons were in meetings, we talked to Bob, and most times we were able to have Bob stay in the meetings. And at the same time, to be able to contribute. Someone talked about Bob's perspectives and humanity. I believe Bob did have, and I believe he had a humanity, and it was expressed so much in reference to his attacker and his perspective on those particular things, which I believe, I agree with him on those particular kinds of things. I was trying to think of something to say and quote somebody. And I'm not sure what he said at his deathbed, but he could have said, "Don't mourn, organize." On the tradition of Malcolm X, who I have a deep and abiding respect for, and it was some comments he was making to some young persons from Tupelo, Mississippi, who were touring Harlem, and he said, I'm willing to work with anyone, no matter what color, red, yellow, blue, green, or orange, as long as you're willing to change the miserable conditions on this earth." And I believe Bob Bob's kind of humanity, and that's how I will remember Bob.